to the burgeoning subject of sexual misconduct and workplace harassment. In the wake of the Me Too movement, still in its relative infancy, it seems that barely a week goes by without some new headline trumpeting the latest alleged misconduct. These matters are no longer confined to internal employment disputes. Fueled by social media and the 24/7 news cycle, they are now typically highly public, high profile, high risk, and high exposure, bringing with them many of the features of traditional white-collar crime matters, including internal investigations, C-suite engagement, board-level investigations, independent investigations, congressional inquiries, and crisis communications. And these cases don't appear to be going away anytime soon. While the complainants are not limited to women, as just one data point in a recent survey, almost 50% of currently employed women report having experienced sexual harassment at work. And with increased willingness to report in today's environment, there has been a marked uptick in the number of complaints that are being brought forward internally at companies, to the EEOC, in civil complaints, and also to law enforcement. And there is seemingly no complaint in today's world that is too small or too vague to warrant serious attention. And if you throw in recent multi-million dollar corporate settlements, changes to statutes of limitation, and pending high profile criminal cases, we can all expect to see a continuing wave of sexual misconduct and abuse matters in the months and years to come. We have a tremendous panel to discuss what's been happening in the world of Me Too, how these cases are similar to and different from traditional white-collar cases, and also some of the unique challenges, and there are plenty of them, that are presented in the investigation, prosecution, and defense of these cases. So let me just take a moment to briefly introduce our panelists. Tammy Albarran, to my far left, is the Deputy General Counsel of Uber Technologies, where she oversees internal and government investigations. Before joining Uber, Tammy was a partner for many years at Covington and Burling, and together with Eric Holder, she led the outside counsel investigation into allegations of sexual misconduct and harassment at Uber. And after completing the investigation and issuing a comprehensive report on Uber's culture, in perhaps the ultimate compliment, she was asked to join the company. She's based in San Francisco. She has been repeatedly recognized for her accomplishments, including as a superb lawyer and one of the top female Latina lawyers in the country. Robert Capers, just next to me on my left, is currently co-head of Errant Fox's government enforcement and white-collar practice. Before joining Errant Fox, Rob served for many years as an assistant United States attorney and then as U.S. attorney for the Eastern District of New York. In government and private practice, Rob has led and overseen many significant white-collar investigations, cases, and trials, including a range of sexual misconduct and workplace harassment matters. In recent years, he has handled a number of misconduct cases, you know, at the crossroads of employment law and potential criminal exposure. So Nancy Kestenbaum, to my right, is co-chair of Covington's White-Collar Defense and Investigations Practice, formerly an AUSA in the Southern District of New York. She has a broad-gauged white-collar practice representing companies, individuals, and boards. In recent years, she's handled a number of matters involving allegations of sexual misconduct and abuse, and she has seen these cases play out from multiple vantage points, as counsel representing the organization, to serving as an independent investigator, to counseling boards of directors. Recent high-profile engagements include representing the United States Olympic Committee, leading an internal investigation for the board of directors of CBS, and serving as the independent investigator in the Choate Rosemary Hall matter. So Cyrus Vance, to my far right, who perhaps needs no introduction, is the District Attorney of New York County, better known as the Manhattan DA's office. In his role as District Attorney, Cy has been at the forefront of some of the most high-profile sexual misconduct cases in the country. And with the indictment of Harvey Weinstein last year, he is currently leading what is hands down the most high-profile case involving sexual abuse and workplace harassment in the country. Cy oversees the Manhattan DA's Sex Crimes Unit, which handles a wide array of sexual abuse and misconduct matters. He also created and oversees a first-of-its-kind human trafficking response unit, and more recently, a work-related sexual violence team. Judge Louis Free, whose name you may have seen as a panelist in the program, unfortunately sends his regrets, having been called out of the country this week on a client matter. But with that, first let me note that we will take questions at the end of the discussion. For those of you who want to pose a question, please come forward and use this microphone so that everyone in the room will be able to hear you. But with that, Cy, let me start with you as someone who has been in the absolute thick of it on the prosecution side and ask you to tell us what you've been seeing in the wake of Me Too in terms of the broadening scope of investigations and enforcement.
Sure. Thank you, first of all, for including me on the panel. And Rob and I are actually colleagues from the Manhattan DA's office many years ago.
I was going to say that.
I first of all start, Joan, by saying I've been head of the DA's office for 9 years. We have a very aggressive sex crimes unit. But I will say that when the Me Too movement became the Me Too movement, and when the scope of alleged misconduct, in some cases absolutely proven misconduct, occurred, I will confess, and I don't think I'm alone, that I was not aware of the extent to which there was workplace sexual violence, nor necessarily the amount of sexual harassment. Now, I've had, like others, many changes in my understanding around crimes, particularly against women. We do not really prosecute cases of prostitution anymore. We understand that those are more often trafficking cases. Domestic violence, when I was a young assistant DA, the way we investigated domestic violence cases really would be embarrassing if it were to be done today, because we understand now the dynamics between one powerful partner in the relationship and one who may be dependent. So those things have evolved over the course of, I'd say, 15 or 20 years. But when the Me Too movement became the Me Too movement, it was an eye-opening for me. So I would say, first of all, I think I'm not alone as the head of an agency. I know we have former Boston DA here and some other state prosecutors. I think this has been a very powerful good thing. It has opened our eyes, and it has made us aware that we need to, in some sense, change, look deeper and change our practices. Let me say that an example would be the creation of the work-related task force in our office. It is a team of 15 lawyers, and they have literally reached out to hundreds of the many thousand companies in New York City in an effort, number one, to help those companies where they want help, to advise them and how to advise their employees or directly advise their employees about sexual misconduct in the workplace, as well as to be a resource for employees from those companies or those companies themselves to call us. I think almost any prosecution office today has to be focused not just on prosecuting, but preventing. If we can prevent a crime from being committed, that's always better than prosecuting it. So I think our work in creating a workplace sexual violence task force, it enables us to really reach out to a broad business community and both teach, and I in quotes, and also be able to listen. And we think both of those things done effectively makes it less likely prospectively there will be serious sexual assaults. As you said, we now with this team are actively engaged with the EEOC and with the Human Rights Commission in New York City So I would say that for the leader of a prosecution agency, number one, it broadened my horizons, and it may be you could say I should have seen this, mm-hmm. but I didn't to the degree to which it is. And I think people like me are experiencing this around the country and shaping their practices now to address what is a reality, but had not been treated by prosecutors traditionally as a reality, and we weren't digging beneath the surface.
Mm-hmm. So I take it you've seen a significant uptick in complaints coming into your office?
I think both the NYPD and our office have seen a significant uptick in reports of rape. We had a hotline, for example, in 2017, which we maintained for survivors to contact on a range of types of cases. There's been about almost a 200% increase in the activity of that hotline between 17 and 2018. 17 when, in October of 2017, when the New Yorker story first broke, and through last year. So there absolutely has been a uptick in reporting. We'll talk later about the difficulties, nonetheless, of sometimes making those cases, mm-hmm. and transferring a report into a real criminal prosecution.
So one of the questions, Nancy, is, you know, we're seeing this heightened corporate exposure, heightened individual exposure. You know, what's driving it? Have there been significant changes in the law, or is it, you know, primarily a change in the environment?
Just briefly before I answer your question, Joan, I have to give a brief disclaimer. Anything I say here today does not reflect the views of my clients, my firm, or necessarily even my own views. I might say things just to be provocative and doesn't relate to any particular matter that I handled. But to answer your question, obviously, as Cy noted, I mean, we all know that the environment has changed. People are speaking up about things that they never would have had the courage to speak up about before, because they wouldn't have thought necessarily anything would have been done about it. And now, obviously, companies and other organizations are doing much more about it. In terms of your question about whether the law has changed, I would say yes and no. In terms of the substantive law, for the most part, the laws of rape and sexual assault and sexual harassment and sexual abuse of minors, for the most part, those laws are the same laws, same statutes that have been around for quite a long time. There has been some expansion in substantive laws. So, for example, I think it was just last week, New York, as some other states have done, passed a statute making so-called revenge porn a crime. In other words, it makes it a crime to share sexually explicit photos or videos without consent and with the intent of causing harm. So that's, you know, expansion, mm-hmm. of the law. And in the civil context, sexual harassment laws have expanded in some ways. But for the most part, the substance of law has remained the same. But what has been changing is there have been a lot of procedural changes, both on the criminal side and on the civil side, that relates to sexual misconduct and sexual harassment. So as you noted, a number of states have either eliminated or greatly expanded their statutes of limitations, especially when they relate to claims of sexual abuse of minors. So California eliminated its statute of limitations as it relates to those types of issues. New York greatly expanded its statute of limitations and enacted a so-called look-back provision intended to revive old claims. So that's just one example of a significant procedural change. There have also been other changes, like laws either limiting or prohibiting non-disclosure agreements in connection with settlements of sexual harassment claims, or making arbitration, eliminating mandatory arbitration provisions. So I think as a result of some of these procedural changes, that will add to the number of cases that can be brought either criminally or civilly, mm-hmm. and make much more public a lot of claims that would have otherwise been dealt with more quietly in the past.
Mm-hmm. So from an outside counsel vantage point, you know, one of the things that I've certainly seen is sort of an uptick in calls about these kinds of issues from companies and organizations who are concerned about making sure that they're handling these issues when they arise in an appropriate way. And I'm interested, Tammy, you know, from the in-house perspective, what you've been seeing in terms of changes and evolution in the way companies are responding to these kinds of issues when they come up.
Sure. So just because it seems like the right thing to do, I'm going to echo Nancy's disclaimer. And then I will say that, you know, a lot of the views that I have are informed by both my in-house as well as my experience as outside counsel. But and in fact, talking to many other counterparts at other companies. But what I would say is I do think that over the last several years, the way in which companies are responding to these types of allegations has evolved. Mm-hmm. I think first and foremost, there is a very deep appreciation for the reputational risks that come with these types of allegations and how companies respond to the allegations. There is also, I think, an appreciation for the fact that if you don't do it right, or if you don't, you know, respond correctly, there, it's going to impact the level of trust that the company has with its employees. So I think it's very important to make sure that you get it right. I think the way that companies are approaching this to make sure that they are doing this right is to really, one, make sure that they are taking all of the allegations seriously, that they are not discounting certain allegations because it may be coming from an employee who perhaps has a performance issue, for example. I do think that they are taking allegations as they come in, taking them very seriously, and then in addition to that, they are making sure that they have processes and procedures that are very clear so that everybody understands what exactly happens when there's an allegation that is raised. That the process is fair to all the parties, so you want to make sure that you're not overreacting without having all of the information. So you want to make sure that the process is fair for all the parties, both the complainant as well as the person against whom the allegation is being raised. So and I think again, you also have to make sure that the process is thorough, it's fair, and it's objective. So I think those are some of the changes that I have seen in terms of how these types of allegations are being treated from internally.
Mm-hmm. And so, Rob, you know, as I mentioned, you've handled a number of matters where there are, you know, internal employment issues. Somebody may be facing, adverse employment action, potential termination. There's also, at least, you know, potentially on the horizon, you know, potential criminal proceedings. How do you think about, managing the issues that come up in that, you know, complex environment?
So I'm going to echo everything that has been said so far, including Nancy's disclaimer. But I think that, you know, Tammy hit it a lot on the head, and it is trying to kind of separate out the interest at hand, right? There's the client's interest, then there are the external interests, and managing them both. And so to Tammy's points, you want to make sure that you have uniform policies in place so that there's a level of credibility that has come, that those policies and procedures are being appropriately followed, that you're not jumping the gun, but that you're getting to the end goal, which is determining, conducting the proper investigation, making the determination of whether it's founded or unfounded. If it's founded, where was the failure and with whom, and at what level is the failure, and trying to correct that, and trying to solve the goals of, or the interests, or satisfy the interests of the client. Now, there could be the threat of the parallel prosecutorial investigation side, and it is the desire to leave that to the prosecutors and not kind of intermingle the two. There's a job that they have to do, and if there's a request of them to the client, and if it's not adverse to the goals of the client, you know, we certainly want to make sure that we adhere to those. For example, if a prosecutor is investigating an allegation of sexual misconduct and is conducting their own grand jury investigation and asks to not interview somebody, you know, we'll have to weigh that, and we'll have to weigh that against what the issues are, or the needs of the client. And if they don't, trample over those needs of the client, then we can adhere to that. And so it's being able to balance the needs of the client and also potentially maintain the relationship that you need to with the prosecutor's office.
Right. Okay, great. I'm so sorry, I just want to turn back to the prosecution side and, and get you to focus on, you know, what some of the unique challenges are in investigating and prosecuting these cases. I think it would be helpful at the get-go to get your thoughts on, you know, for this audience, which is very familiar with white-collar criminal matters. You know, how are these cases similar to, how are they different from, you know, other traditional criminal matters that your office pursues?
Well, individually, the you know, the cases are similar in the sense that many of the cases involve a discrete set of facts and application of law, and then an assessment of whether you can meet the burden of proof. As was said, the laws in this area have been pretty steady for a long time, with the introduction of revenge porn and what's called sexploitation, which is criminal now. So, I think the substantive law hasn't changed hugely. In terms of how these acts may occur within a company and to what degree there is any liability to company executives or to the company itself, that is a shift. But I don't think it's a shift that is that far afield from other shifts. I mean, you have a corporation which is aware of allegations of sexual misconduct or sexual assault, and that corporation or individuals in management seek to make sure that doesn't get told or retaliates against the complainant, then you do now, as you now move into the area of what is the potential criminal corporate liability. Is the crime facilitation or is it obstruction of justice? And those are the kinds of questions that can be asked and the kinds of investigations that have been commenced to understand who within the corporation knew what and what was their response, and was any of that response designed to, in a criminal fashion, with intent to suppress, hide, obscure the facts of the underlying crime. And although there are many more expert people than me here in the room in terms of securities fraud, I mean, there is going to be the issue whether or not, you know, under New York law and probably under federal law, whether there is if the company and its management knows of these issues and fails to address a potentially material issue to its shareholders, or that the controlling person within the company is falling beneath the level of performance that's expected. Those, I think, can push you into, now you're looking at corporate responsibility, more typically, I think, civil, but nonetheless, under the Martin Act and New York, there's still potential criminal liability. Does that answer your question?
Yes, it does. Thank you. So the next piece I'd like to move to, because obviously all of these cases, white collar criminal matters, present a lot of challenges from an investigation and prosecution standpoint. Are there any things that stand out for you that are unique or specific to the sexual misconduct cases?
Sure. And I think there are probably many practitioners in the room here who have had experiences with clients or friends, perhaps, who have been the victim of sexual assault. These are, I believe, among the most difficult cases that we handle. And I think child abuse is another area that is equally challenging. But many times we're asked to decide who is telling the truth between two people that are complete strangers to us. And there are obviously dynamics in a sexual assault investigation I would say akin to other kinds of investigations where there is uneven power dynamic. Mm-hmm. In the workplace, you have women who I think the vast majority of incidents that happen go unreported, and a substantial number of instances of sexual assault are not reported outside of the workplace. So there is a reluctance to report because, one, you think you won't be believed. Two, you think you'll be punished. And three, you think you'll be humiliated. And all three can happen. And four, you may enter a public space with your personal story that is simply something that you just don't know how to handle. Mm-hmm. I never told my mother that I was raped by, mm-hmm. you know, this individual, and I don't want my mother to know that. So mm-hmm. in our office, and I expect offices all around the country, if a sexual assault survivor does not wish to essentially go forward with the prosecution, we honor that, which is interestingly unlike many other types of criminal investigations. A witness in a murder case does not have that option, but I think the practice in our office, and I expect practices all across the country, with rare exceptions, the survivor, we won't proceed with a rape charge unless the survivor, in fact, wants to go forward. So there's a lot of complex dynamics, and I truly feel I understand so much better now the fear of survivors entering as a role of a victim or a witness in a case that is so white hot in the public eye that every tabloid in the country is trying to find out something that's embarrassing about them, and that's a very, very, very hard thing to do.
So when you have, you know, one of these matters that's, you know, very much, you know, in the spotlight, how does the fact of public pressure or the role of advocacy groups, you know, end up, you know, influencing or affecting the way you proceed?
I think generally positively. Let me start with the positive. As I said, I think after the initiation and explosion of Me Too, I felt that our office had not gone back and taken a look at how we are dealing with victims, survivors in these cases, where we're using best practices. And we brought in an outside company to really to analyze all our practices in the sex crimes area. But we have, for example, begun application of what is called FETI training. And I can only tell you what two letters are in that acronym. One is forensic, and the last one is interviews. But it starts with the process of understanding that trauma to a sexual assault victim is not linear. And that when you are a young lawyer, you probably sat the police officer or victim down and asked them to, okay, this, ask this chronologically, this. And if they didn't have that information at hand, you might assume that they were not being truthful and therefore discredit the overall story they're telling. Or you might have gotten harsh with them and said, listen, unless I get the full truth from you, this is not going forward. I think we understand better today that a forensic interview or even a interview by a prosecutor does not have to be linear and may best not be linear in trying to get the victim to remember all that happened at the time of the sexual assault. So we do, and our whole office has now been trained on this beyond sexual assault. So that's one thing that's happened, which I think is very significant. And I can't remember what the other part of the question was.
Just asking about the some of the challenges that are presented, where you have, you know, advocacy groups, maybe survivor groups, you have expectations in this environment, and how that sort of bumps up against the responsibilities that you have.
I think one is a expectation, which I understand from the point of view of the survivors and many of the advocates and interest groups who work on their behalf, is a feeling that prosecutors have for too long not believed the survivor, and as a consequence, time has proven that there have been many sexual assault cases that may have occurred, but were not in fact brought because the prosecutor and his or her team didn't believe the victim. I think there is a philosophy among some today that if a survivor says, this happened to me, then that's a case that should be indicted and charged. Believe what she's saying rather than starting out disbelieving what she's saying. And I think that's a very important distinction. At the end of the day, however, I think our role and our responsibility as prosecutors is to be more engaged than at that level. And we obviously are not civil litigants. We have the responsibility to only bring those cases that we believe are in fact sex crimes and we believe that the evidence proves it. So finally, I think that, again, probably every lawyer in this room has been under pressure when a case becomes a huge thing, and advocacy groups are protesting or writing, and there's a lot of anger. And I think at the end of the day, I always imagined if you were a professional basketball player and you're standing at the free throw line and you're trying to get the ball into the hoop, and there's 1,000 people behind the, waving flags to try to get you off. I think we all just have to really steady it out, follow process, which is key. The process of investigation, that ensures the integrity, I think, of what you're doing, and not let the noise distract you.
And if I could,
go ahead.
Just to piggyback off of that, kind of putting back on my old prosecutor's hat, is one of the most important things inside was saying it was to not overreact and not overpromise. Well, promise is that you will give it a full and thorough investigation. What I think has happened with the evolution of these types of investigations is they have become more robust, more sophisticated, and have recognized the complexities of those. And so it's, as Cy has said, and as he has developed in his office, kind of responding to the times and continuing to evolve the investigatory techniques so that you can promise that the investigation will be full and thorough. Mm-hmm. We don't know what the results will be at the conclusion of them, but you can trust that the process is going to function as it should. Mm-hmm. And that's important. Mm-hmm. And that's both in the criminal context, and I think you all will agree, mm-hmm. in the in-house, mm-hmm. With the internal investigations, ensuring that there is a robust, continually evolving process that's in place, that so that when these allegations are made, whatever the external pressures are, folks could be assured and reassured that what needs to be done is going to be done. Mm-hmm. And you may or may not be happy with what the results are, but when we get to the results, we'll get there. But what you will know is that we did everything we were supposed to do.
So just a couple things I want to add to both of what you all said, but the first is on the prevention side. I agree that it's super important to put systems and processes in place to not just respond, but also to help prevent. And I know from a company's perspective, you're seeing a lot of focus on diversity and inclusion efforts, right? So it's not just, it's making sure that the environment that you have in the workplace is inclusive, where people feel safe, where people feel that they trust management and they trust that the company's gonna do right. So, making sure, we like to talk about, as a company, one of our culture norms is we do the right thing, period, right? And so that means that, we are encouraging our employees that if they see something, they should say something. We don't want it to get to a point where we have an actual sexual assault in the workplace or, sexual harassment in the workplace. We want to be able, if you see something that just doesn't feel right, make sure that you report it. And then from a process perspective is making sure that you provide your employee base with various avenues in which to raise these concerns. They can raise them with their managers, they can raise them with their skip level managers, they can raise them through a helpline, they can raise issues anonymously. So, giving the employees various ways in which they can raise issues, even if they haven't gotten to a certain level. And I think in combination with that, you also have to make sure that your managers are well-trained, right? So that's another thing that we're seeing is, in particular, I think, in the tech space, where you have very a younger population, if you will, making sure that your managers are sufficiently trained up to know when they see something, what are they supposed to do? When someone raises a concern, what are they supposed to do? And in particular, when someone raises a concern and says, but I want you to keep this confidential, right? What do you do with that? Mm-hmm. And understanding that as managers, there are certain responsibilities that you have because the company can be imputed with that knowledge, and making sure that we then take the appropriate steps. So those are, I think, things that from an in-house perspective, we're also consistently thinking about, is making sure that we have an inclusive culture where people feel safe to raise concerns before they become bigger issues, and that as a company, we are responding to those and addressing those issues appropriately and timely.
So back on the prosecution side, and asking you to put back on your federal prosecutor hat, and based on your experience in the EDNY, you know, how do these cases play out at the federal level, and what are some of the theories and, you know, statutes that are relied upon in pursuing sexual abuse and misconduct cases?
Sure. So in my experience, they largely fall into three different areas, and look, there's some overlap that we have with local prosecutors, and, you know, Cy, we've talked about this a bit. More specifically, U.S. Attorney's offices, federal prosecutor's offices handle matters that have a larger federal interest. So if they are in the context of, you know, one of the areas are civil rights prosecutions of violations of people's civil rights while they are in custody, whether they be imprisoned in correctional centers, whether they are being detained by police officers who are conducting a law enforcement action. We've prosecuted cases where local police officers who have taken people into custody for traffic violations or have arrested them for committing crimes, then sexually assaulted them. And so those would be what we call 242, 18 U.S.C. section 242 violations. And the theory behind that is deprivation of constitutional civil rights under the color of law by subjecting them to cruel and unusual punishment, namely forced sexual assault. And so that's one area federal prosecutions, prosecutions of sexual assault crimes are handled. Federal prosecutions are another area, are in international and domestic sex trafficking rings. And for domestic sex trafficking rings, they would be larger rings that perhaps we have sex trafficking or child trafficking cases where we have bad actors who are bringing people in from other states subjecting them to a life of prostitution, or we have international sex trafficking cases. We've had a number of multinationals, including Mexicans and folks from Asia, who are trafficking in people, bringing them into the country, promising them a better life, and then withholding their papers, forcing them into sex slavery. And so those are 18 U.S.C. 1591 sex trafficking cases, and that's sex trafficking of an adult and a minor in interstate or foreign commerce. We have conspiracy. We also have alien smuggling charges, which is 8 U.S.C. 1324, and that is illegally and intentionally smuggling an alien into the country to subject them to some criminal conduct, mainly prostitution. Federal prosecutions, a large number of federal prosecutions that handle international and domestic enticement cases, where you'll have bad actors who use the internet, social media, to entice minors to come in from out of the country, or to entice minors to travel over interstate lines. Of course, you also have the Mann Act, which covers those types of crimes as well, and those are the theories of transporting people in interstate commerce and international commerce for the purpose of engaging them in sexual abuse crimes against their will.
So, Nancy, turning to defense of these cases, both in the context of companies and individuals, and maybe thinking about it first in the corporate context, I'm going to ask you the same question that I asked Asai, in terms of, you know, how you think about the similarities and the differences between sort of a traditional, more traditional white collar case and these cases specifically in the sexual misconduct area.
So, you know, these cases have a lot of similarities with white collar cases, but there are also differences. I know when I first started doing this work, a lot of people would say to me, and I'm sure you've all got this question, like, why are you doing this kind of work? Isn't this employment work? And I think the answer to that is a few things, and this is how the matters are similar. A fact investigation is a fact investigation, and the basic blocking and tackling is what everyone in this room does every day. It's interviewing witnesses and reviewing documents. And what white-collar lawyers also do is, you know, we are able to keep our mind on the basketball hoop and not, and what you talked about in terms of process, and not rush to judgment until we actually have seen the actual evidence, which in this context, the Me Too context, the rest of the world doesn't seem to have as much ability to do. They often is a view of either, I believe the women without knowing the actual evidence, or on the other side, he's a good guy, and so therefore he couldn't have done it. So I think white-collar lawyers bring those skills of being able to actually conduct an investigation and understand what the actual evidence is. There are also other features that are similar to investigations in the white-collar context. First of all, obviously, there is the specter of potential regulatory enforcement investigations, civil litigation, similar to what we all experience in other types of white-collar matters. And also these matters at core often bring up other issues about the company and organization that are familiar to us in the white-collar context, things about corporate governance and controls and tone at the top, which sometimes these issues have a way of, causing the company to realize that there are things that can be improved and enhanced, and that might be why some of these issues went on. But there are also differences in terms of these investigations from traditional white-collar investigations, and in my mind, many of the differences have to do with witnesses. First of all, in a typical white-collar investigation, in my experience, most of the witnesses you're going to interview are either current or former company employees. And in these investigations, you could interview current or company employees, but often, maybe even the majority of people you might interview are third-party individuals who aren't employees and don't necessarily have a connection. I mean, we had a matter where a company called us because the Wall Street Journal was poking around about whether its CEO had engaged in date rape many, many years ago with a girlfriend. Had nothing to do with, she didn't work at the company, had nothing to do with that, but it was going to have a huge effect on the company if that article was published. And you're talking about entirely, dealing with people entirely outside the company, which in my view is different. And that what that means is that when you're talking to witnesses, when you're interviewing them, unlike what all of us do in our sleep at the outset of most privileged investigations, which is give Upjohn warnings, you don't necessarily give Upjohn warnings, and you certainly shouldn't give Upjohn warnings at the beginning of an interview if it doesn't apply, but instead you have to craft a preface that is similar to Upjohn in that the purpose of the preface is to make sure that that individual understands the context and ramifications of the interview. And usually in the sexual misconduct context, that means often discussions about anonymity and confidentiality, because witnesses often do not want their name to be disclosed or what they said to be disclosed. And so you have to give assurances that as far as you can go, but not more than you go in terms of that. And so those are just some of the kinds of differences that I see in terms of handling this work versus traditional white-collar matters.
And I take it you cannot, offer confidentiality in the context of these matters any more than you can in other contexts.
Yeah, I mean, you certainly can't offer absolute confidentiality. Mm-hmm. You can say you will work with them, but you certainly have to have carve-outs, especially if you get legal process. Obviously, you have to give that carve-out. Or also sometimes, especially when you're talking about child abuse. I know I will say, even if it's not mandated under law, that if I feel that I need to make a disclosure to protect a minor from harm, that I tell them that. And this is before you've had the conversation, so you don't necessarily even know what they're going to say, but you want to make sure that you can't promise absolute confidentiality no matter what they tell you.
Yeah. Can I just add something? Because a couple things that I've seen done, and that is always an issue in many kind of investigations in the in-house context, is witnesses wanting to make sure that what they share won't get back to anybody. And I think there, What investigators can do is hopefully the company has an anti-retaliation policy, and you can reinforce that throughout the conversation and ensure that, you know, whether or not you can't promise confidentiality, you'll do your best to as best as you can, but you can say, like, you know, the company has an anti-retaliation policy. This is, you know, this is the expectation that no one's going to actually, there's not going to be any adverse action against you because of the issues that we're talking about today. So that's one thing. What I have seen done, and there are times when, for example, when someone is looking at an allegation and that's being investigated by outside counsel, I think many times from an in-house perspective, we don't necessarily need to know who the outside lawyer spoke with, right? We just need to know this is the conclusion. These are the facts, and so you don't always, even from our in-house perspective, we don't always have to know who the witnesses are. Mm-hmm. Really, we just need to know that you've talked to a certain number of witnesses, you've talked to people, and this is what they've said. At least from my perspective, I'm not sure that you always need to disclose who said what, mm-hmm. to be able to come up with whatever ultimate decision you're going to make about the individual.
Mm-hmm. So Nancy, one other question, just back on this topic of corporate exposure, which, you know, Cy outlined a number of pathways in which the corporation can find itself, you know, with significant exposure in connection with these matters. But I think there's a tendency to think of these as cases that involve very personal misconduct and the traditional principles of, you know, vicarious liability don't attach in the same way or as naturally. So I'm interested, you know, from a defense perspective, you know, how you have seen these issues move upstream to more generally affect the company?
Well, yeah, there's a long history and well-developed case law about when a company can be liable for or vicariously liable for sexual harassment or retaliation of its employees. But, you know, as Cy alluded to, now there's potentially expanded exposure for companies. You know, on the civil side, there have been a number of purported class actions and shareholder derivative suits claiming that, you know, this issue went on and the company either failed to properly disclose it in its, you know, its disclosures or were misleading, or that senior management or the board was deficient and breached their fiduciary duties because they either didn't have sufficient controls or didn't, you know, allowed it to go on and things like that. So for example, several years ago, HP was sued in a securities class action in connection with issues involving its former CEO Mark Hurd, and there the plaintiffs said that the fact that the company had touted the company's ethics was, you know, made their disclosures misleading. Federal court dismissed that, and the Ninth Circuit affirmed that dismissal, though, saying that, you know, those statements and omissions were not misleading and not actionable. So I think these cases can have challenges. More recently, last year, Fox settled a shareholder derivative suit and paid $90 million. And agreed to some compliance enhancements in connection with, you know, allegations of breach of fiduciary duty involving, you know, its sexual harassment issues. More recently, Wynn Resorts have been sued in a variety of cases. It's public that CBS is facing a purported class action. And then, as Cy said, you know, his office is investigating a number of these matters. The New York Attorney General sued the Weinstein Company, alleging a variety of legal violations, including New York City and state human rights laws. Fox, in its disclosure of its civil suit, disclosed that the U.S. Attorney's Office in the Southern District of New York had been investigating it in connection with, you know, potential securities fraud issues. The Catholic Church faces, you know, widespread scrutiny, including criminal scrutiny. So the Pennsylvania DA did their investigation and issued their report. And then it was reported that after that, the U.S. Attorney's Office in Philadelphia, so in other words, DOJ, was criminally investigating the Catholic Church. So, you know, there is the potential. On the other hand, you know, especially when we're talking about criminal liability, I don't think this isn't like the typical white-collar case where if an individual employee or agent takes an action then there could, the employer might be vicariously liable. Because here, as you said, the actions are mostly personal and not done in any way to benefit the corporation. So unless you have something along the lines of what Cy said, like obstruction or specific facilitation, I think those are very challenging cases and don't neatly fit into legal theories for vicarious liability for the employer in the same way as a typical white-collar case.
Mm-hmm. So Tammy, let me come back to you and ask you, when one of these issues arises internally, how do you think about it in terms of what kind of investigation is warranted? You know, when, if it remains an option, it's sort of an HR review, when it's sort of in-house counsel led, maybe in conjunction with HR, when you're bringing in outside counsel, maybe when you're thinking about a need for outside counsel who has no prior relationship with the company. How do you think about gauging a complaint and what the appropriate way to respond is?
Yeah, so that gets really complicated when you're a company as big as ours who that works with lots of different law firms, because it's really difficult to find a law firm that actually is truly kind of independent, has never done any work for us. But in terms of whether or not we handle things internally versus externally, I think there's a lot of times, and then who internally would handle it? Is this an HR? Is this kind of the employment legal team? Is it the compliance team? So for us, it really depends on the nature of the allegation and the way that we are set up internally. If it's an allegation that relates to my manager was mean to me in a meeting, I didn't like the way he responded to something I said, then that might be something that we view as more of an HR issue that we would have our HR folks handle. If it's something that is being raised, or for example, if it's raised against an executive, I think those obviously we take very seriously as well. But for the most part, it's the nature of the allegation, it's who the allegation is raised against. And then, you also look at the complainant if you know who the complainant is, or if the complainant is somebody who is, for example, a whistleblower, right? And in that case, you want to tread very carefully in terms of whether you handle this internally or externally. Mm-hmm. And then, depending on the actual allegation raised, you may determine that, this is something that either for whatever resource constraints, whatnot, may need to go external. And then we'll evaluate whether or not we need a law firm that is truly independent, if it warrants an independent investigation, or if it's something that we can send to a law firm that we may have a pre-existing relationship with, but who we know and trust to be truly objective.
Right. So one of the other things that I think would be helpful to get some perspective on is some of the significant challenges that are facing individuals when they are accused of sexual misconduct. Obviously, those challenges are only significantly increased in the context of social media and news reporting, where the reputational hit can be so immediate. We've talked about the imperative of process in handling these matters and making sure that there is a fair process and also a process that is perceived to be fair. But Tammy, Rob, interested in your thoughts about the challenges from the perspective of the individual accused and steps to help ensure that the process remains fair.
Do you want to start, Rob?
Yeah, go ahead.
So I think what I would say is there are sometimes, in particular, when it's an allegation that is being raised by somebody who is very well regarded in the company, for example, there's sometimes an initial reaction to kind of rush to judgment. And I think, we have to kind of resist that urge and make sure that the individual is not, we're not treating the individual as guilty unless proven innocent, right? We have to make sure that everybody is given due process, that we are following our procedures, and that we are looking at the process as something that, at the end of the day, regardless of what the outcome is, you may disagree with the outcome, you may not like the outcome, but you cannot you know, attack or critique the process, because it was a thorough process. So I think for us, it's incredibly important that we do what we can to protect the privacy of all of the individuals who are involved, both the witnesses, the complainant, and whoever it is that is being accused. It becomes incredibly difficult when, you know, you have a situation where you have company leaks, for example, because in that instance, you have a person who may have, there may be an allegation raised against them, you've fully investigated it, there's no merit, it's not been substantiated, and yet the fact that there was an investigation or an allegation raised can be disastrous from a reputational and professional perspective. And so I think, you know, we have to be very mindful of what we do and make sure that we are following a very tight process to ensure that you know, we are not doing anything that could potentially, you know, impact the privacy of the individuals involved. But it gets very complicated.
I'd agree with all that, and particularly the leak part, which is why it's important to have in your process a decision on who's going to be involved in the investigation, mm-hmm. and how broad or how narrow the investigation needs to be. Mm-hmm. That's one thing. The other thing you have to always concern yourself with is the idea of piling on. You know, there's one discrete allegation that gets piled on or lumped in with hostile work environment. He said something to me that I didn't like. He targets me for, you know, because we have personality differences, or conversely, the victim is not a high performer, has had to be put on some remedial measures or something like that. And so it's important for the process to be tight, to be closely held if necessary, and to the best of your, for those reasons, and for the, and you need to resist the temptation to react to whatever the external pressures are, mm-hmm. with social media, with leaks, with Facebook, with everything else, to not take the bait and talk about the existence of the investigation or the extent of the investigation to ensure that it's appropriately controlled.
Mm-hmm. So Nancy, Tammy mentioned independent investigation. I think independence means different things to different people. Can you comment on you know, what you view to be the essential elements of an independent investigation, and maybe the spectrum of different kinds of investigations that end up being referred to as an independent investigation?
Sure. So there's not sort of one definition of independent investigation. I mean, because organizations are often facing these issues, often want to undertake and to be able to say that they've undertaken an independent investigation. But what they mean by that can vary greatly. I guess at its basic level, it usually means that it can often mean that the board or a committee of the board is overseeing the investigation rather than management. Mm-hmm. And it can mean that the investigator has, you know, doesn't have prior ties with the company or organization. It also often means, especially in this context, that the investigator will have a lot of autonomy in terms of how he or she goes about investigating, in terms of what they do, mm-hmm. what they pursue, and how they go about it, and then, of course, in terms of their findings. In the sexual misconduct context, and especially you see this in the context of sexual abuse against minors, though, there's sometimes even more extreme in terms of independence, and I know, Joan, that you're familiar with this. So, for example, when our client, the United States Olympic Committee, faced issues concerning sexual abuse in gymnastics, it decided to commission a truly independent investigation and hired Joan and her law firm to do it. And when Choate, the boarding school, hired me to conduct a similarly truly independent investigation, and what I mean by that is there's no attorney-client relationship between the investigator and the organization, not even with the board. The investigator truly acts as a principal in that situation, you know, makes all the decisions themselves, often will, you know, if asked, write a report that they've completely written themselves. And, you know, that, I haven't seen that, frankly, in the corporate context. I've seen that more with not-for-profits who are facing these issues. And like I said, especially, you see that in, you know, schools or other not-for-profits facing issues or reports of potential childhood sexual abuse.
So independent investigations in that context that you just described, you know, are relatively rare in the world of investigations. Are there sort of specific, you know, pitfalls that present in the context of that type of investigation where the lawyer conducting the investigation is, as you say, acting essentially as a principal?
Well, first of all, any organization that decides they want to do that should think long and hard. I mean, there's obviously a lot of risks that go along with it. If an organization makes that decision, they obviously have decided, especially in the wake of likely investigations and litigation, I mean, but an organization that decides to do that has obviously made a decision that the credibility of the investigation and transparency is of paramount importance. But that can mean, you know, either issues in terms of, you know, privilege or privilege waiver, I mean, in terms of how the investigation is structured and what is made public. There's also, frankly, heightened risks for the investigator herself or himself. So, for example, you mentioned Judge Louis Free, who was we hoped would join us. You know, he was one of the first people to, I mean, people have been investigating these issues for a long time, but he, of course, handled the Penn State investigation. And after issuing his report, and, you know, there was a lot of aftermath there, but including that former Penn State President Graham, I may mispronounce his name, but Spanier, sued Judge Free for libel and defamation based on what Judge Free had written in his report. President Spanier was convicted, criminally convicted of child endangerment, and yet was suing Louis Free. And eventually that case was dismissed, but not until, you know, it took quite a while to wend its way to get to that point. So, you know, there are definitely heightened risks all around with these matters.
So I want, in just a moment, to open it up to questions, but Cy, I thought I'd come back to you as someone, you know, who has had a particular vantage point on the way these cases get defended and ask you if you have observations that might be helpful to this audience about, you know, some of what does and doesn't work from your perspective in terms
from the defense lawyer's perspective?
And from your vantage point.
Right, and I was a defense lawyer for 20 years before I became DA.
You speak so from all sides.
I honestly don't believe there's that much difference. And we've all talked about the subtle differences between investigating a white collar case involving sexual assault. But at the end of the day, if I am looking for the corporation to respond to our legitimate requests for information, and that may mean that they share their internal investigation with us or share information that they've generated with us, and if they choose not to, then the relationship is slightly different and can be more, we're not getting the information, so now we're going to put people in the grand jury, and we are going to, you know, take their ability to solve their own problem out of their hands and take it to ours. So at the end of the day, I think most prosecutors would say you expect the corporate counsel to do what he or she, her client, what the client wants ultimately, but you expect them to be counseling the client smartly, and that this is not, this prosecutor's office is not going away by you not cooperating. In fact, it probably is going to just make it more intense. So I think we look for respectful responses, intelligent responses. Can I add one thing about the Me Too movement, for going back? Because I don't think I mentioned it, but what I think the Me Too movement broke, in my view, was open fact that people who are in, that when one is victimized, one can continue a relationship with the person who is victimizing them. Mm-hmm. And it's very complicated. And just as a wife can be raped, a woman in the workplace can be assaulted sexually, and then can go out to dinner or appear to act completely normally to the two third parties in the same time she's in the room with the man who attacked her. And there may be an exchange of emails. These are very complex personal dynamics in the workplace. She has this job, assume it's a she. She needs this job, and she is balancing mental, mental pulls on her. And I think what I think Me Too has helped open the eyes of the public that this is a whole nother area where the complex dynamics between abuser and abused are seen. As I said, we saw, we understand it now in trafficking. We understand when a trafficked woman gets up and says, "No, I love him. He didn't beat me." And then you play a, you know, a wiretap of him beating her, or she's got a broken arm, or a domestic violence relationship where the spouse goes back to the husband who abuses her. So we now understand this, I think, better in the workplace as well. And I don't think we had that window. The Cosby trial, I think, set perhaps a new legal standard, which I think is going to be applied going forward in cases where juries, I believe, are going to be instructed perhaps by expert witnesses about this phenomenon in the way that we've used expert witnesses in domestic violence and sex trafficking.
Thank you. I mean, these are obviously extremely fraught and complex cases. So with that, I know we got started a little late, but we have a few minutes to take questions from the audience. Again, I've been asked to ask anyone with a question to come up to the microphone so that everyone else in the room will be able to hear the question.
Mr. Vance. And this is less of a white collar question. I wanted to pick up, Cy, on your point that you do not prosecute cases where the victim does not want to cooperate. And having tried a case in a domestic violence case where the victim refused to cooperate and actually took the stand and refused to cooperate very vociferously, I'm curious whether that stance is flexible, because if you have someone who is either a serial rapist or this was a devastating case and you can make a case without the victim, why wouldn't you do that to put this person behind bars?
For just context, it is true in domestic violence, we have understood for some time now, we want to build cases that essentially have independent proof from the survivor, him or herself, right? That you almost don't need them to testify because you've got other objective evidence. Because when they do testify, they may be very conflicted, as you say. I will just say that in my 9 years as district attorney, and I stay in close contact with our prosecutors, I'm not aware of an instance where, over the objection of a survivor, we have taken that case forward. I personally understand very well the underlying conundrum. If this woman does not come forward, assuming it's a woman, and testify, then this man gets away. But that's, I will say, that is it is happening today. There are cases of credible sexual assault. Maybe it's barred by the statute of limitations, maybe it's not, but we do err on the side of not exposing the victim to the trauma of a trial. But there's a really, I think, understandable public policy argument to your point, and this is in tension, and that tension, I don't think the story is over. And there are maybe other offices around the country who do not approach that choice like we do.
Because it seems that you shouldn't approach it that differently. It should be, even though it's a very different crime, it should be treated somewhat similarly to other crimes in terms of not forcing the person to testify. I'm not saying that, but if you can build a case without her or him, there's no, I think we would. Okay.
That's difficult, but it's difficult to do often, right, in the kind of cases we're talking about where there often isn't clear corroborating evidence and the sexual assault occurred in private, no rape kit was ever done or taken, and that kind of independent evidence is less likely to exist. But I'm glad you asked the question, because I think it's a very important one.
Thanks.
Thanks.
Oh. definitely not tall enough for this question. So I'm wondering, just sort of given the kinds of reports that you all are getting or inquiries that you're getting, obviously you probably can't refer to any of them specifically, but how close do you think we are to sort of the crest of the wave that we've been seeing for the last year or two? You know, how far away do you think we are from sort of reaching the end of that?
Well, let me jump in. I'm not aware of another, and there may be another criminal prosecution other than the one in our office against Harvey Weinstein that deals with facts coming out of the Me Too movement. And someone correct me if I'm wrong. And sometimes I feel, why are we alone in this? So I would say my reaction is, if I am correct that there are so few cases that have been brought, I think perhaps how these cases actually play out in court and how they result may very well impact the willingness of other survivors to come forward or not. So I think it's too early to tell.
Yeah, and I would only observe that in terms of, you know, incoming calls from organizations and companies who are facing these issues, I don't sense that there's a crest of the wave yet. It's obviously very hard to have a crystal ball on the future. I do believe that many organizations are escalating matters that would not have been escalated to outside counsel a number of years ago, and I don't see any tailing off of that at this point. You know, Nancy also mentioned, for example, the change in the statute of limitations in New York. I know there's a fair bit of attention to what the impact of that will be, because it will open up for a period of time the ability for people who previously would have been barred by the statute of limitations. It'll open up the opportunity for them to come forward. And there is a fair bit of sort of commentary about, you know, the potential for that to unleash, you know, a significant wave of additional matters that previously were too old to be pursued.
Yeah, and I don't have none of us have a crystal ball. If I had to predict, I think you'll continue to see these matters come up for the next few years. But we're dealing now with a reckoning, a historical reckoning of 2019 and backwards. So I don't think that 10 years from, you know, they're going to be a drop off where sadly you'll probably still have some of these matters, but not at the rate we're seeing them now. I mean, one, in addition to the workplace matters, I do think that schools and other youth serving organizations, I mean, it's a very sad statement, but I'm having now done a lot of that work, I think there's sadly a lot more out there probably to do. And I think that those organizations are just learning about and grappling with those issues. And I think those too will take, you know, some years to continue to play out.
Don't want to stand in the way of everyone's coffee break, but I know that everyone on the panel would be happy to stick around for a few minutes if there are other questions that you would like to raise. Thank you all very much.
Thank you,
John. Thank you.